That was a glorious day. The sun was shining from a cloudless sky, and there was hardly a breath of wind anywhere. Our squadron was going towards Southampton on patrol at 15,000 feet when I saw three Junkers 88 bombers about 4 miles away flying across our bows. I reported this to our squadron leader, and he replied, "Go after them with your section." So I led my section of aircraft round towards the bombers. We chased hard after them, but when we were about a mile behind, we saw the 88s fly straight into a squadron of Spitfires. I used to fly a Spitfire myself, and I guessed it was curtains for the three Junkers. I was right, and they were all shot down in quick time, with no pickings for us. I must confess I was very disappointed, for I had never fired at a Hun in my life and was longing to have a crack at them. So we swung round again and started to climb up to 18,000 feet over Southampton to rejoin our squadron. I was still a long way from the squadron when suddenly, very close, in rapid succession, I heard four big bangs. They were the loudest noises I had ever heard, and they had been made by four cannon shells from a Messerschmitt 110 hitting my machine. The first shell tore through the hood over my cockpit and sent splinters into my left eye. One splinter, I discovered later, nearly severed my eyelid. I couldn't see through that eye for blood. The second cannon shell struck my spare petrol tank and set it on fire. The third shell crashed into the cockpit and tore off my right trouser leg. The fourth shell struck the back of my left shoe. It shattered the heel of the shoe and made quite a mess of my left foot. But I didn't know anything about that either until later. Anyway, the effect of these four shells was to make me dive away to the right to avoid further shells. Then I started cursing myself for my carelessness. What a fool I'd been, I thought. What a fool. I was just thinking of jumping out when suddenly a Messerschmitt 110 whizzed underneath me and got right in my gun sights. Fortunately, no damage had been done to my windscreens or sights, and when I was chasing the Junkers, I had switched everything on, so everything was set for a fight. I pressed the gun button, for the Messerschmitt was in nice range. He was going like mad, twisting and turning as he tried to get away from my fire, so I pushed the throttle wide open. Both of us must have been doing about 400 as we went down together in a dive. First he turned left, then right, then left and right again. He did three turns to the right and finally a fourth turn to the left. I remember shouting out loud at him when I first saw him, "I'll teach you some manners, you Hun," and I shouted other things as well. I knew I was getting him nearly all the time I was firing. By this time, it was pretty hot inside my machine from the burst petrol tank. I couldn't see much flame, but I reckon it was there all right. I remember looking once at my left hand, which was keeping the throttle open. It seemed to be in the fire itself, and I could see the skin peeling off it, yet I had little pain. Unconsciously, too, I had drawn my feet up under my parachute on the seat to escape the heat, I suppose. Well, I gave the Hun all I had, and the last I saw of him was when he was going down, with his right wing lower than the left wing. I gave him a parting burst, and as he disappeared, started thinking about saving myself. I decided it was about time I left the aircraft and bailed out, so I immediately jumped up from my seat. But first of all, I hit my head against the framework of the hood, which was all that was left. I cursed myself for a fool, pulled the hood back, wasn't I relieved when it slid back beautifully, and jumped up again. Once again, I bounced back into my seat, but I had forgotten to undo the straps holding me in. One of them snapped, so I had only three to undo. Then I left the machine. I suppose I was about 12 to 15,000 feet when I bailed out. Immediately, I started somersaulting downwards, and after a few turns like that, I found myself diving headfirst for the ground. After a second or two of this, I decided to pull the ripcord. The result was that I immediately straightened up and began to float down. Then an aircraft, a Messerschmitt, I afterwards heard, came tearing past me. I decided to pretend that I was dead and hung limply by the parachute straps. The Messerschmitt came back once, and I kept my eyes closed, but I didn't get the bullets I was half expecting. I don't know if he fired at me. The main thing is that I wasn't hit. While I was coming down like that, I had a look at myself. I could see the bones of my left hand showing through the knuckles. Then, for the first time, I discovered I'd been wounded in the foot. Blood was oozing out of the lace holes of my left shoe. My right hand was pretty badly burned, too. So I hung down a bit longer, and then decided to try my limbs, just to see if they would work. Thank goodness they did. I still had my oxygen mask over my face, but my hands were in too bad a state to take it off. I tried to, but I couldn't manage it. I found, too, that I had lost one trouser leg, and the other was badly torn, and my tunic was just like a lot of torn rags, so I wasn't looking very smart. Then, after a bit more of this dangling down business, I began to ache all over, and my arms and legs began to hurt a lot. When I got lower, I saw I was in danger of coming down in the sea. I knew I didn't stand unearthly if I did, because I wouldn't have been able to swim a stroke with my hands like that. But I managed to float inland. Then I saw a high-tension cable below me and thought it would finish me if I hit that. Fortunately, I was traveling towards a nice open field. When I was about 100 feet from the ground, I saw a cyclist and heard him ring his bell. I was surprised to hear the bicycle bell and realized I had been coming down in absolute silence. I bellowed at the cyclist, but I don't suppose he heard me. Finally, I touched down in the field and fell over. Fortunately, it was a very calm day. My parachute just floated down and stayed down without dragging me along, as they sometimes do. I had a piece of good news almost immediately. One of the people who came along and who had watched the combat said they had seen the Messerschmitt 110 dive straight into the sea, so it hadn't been such a bad day after all.